You know, I used to preach without these, but can't do that anymore. It's great to be with everyone this morning. You know, I prayed member by member this morning, and I thanked God for every one of you. And I thank God for those who are going to come in who I didn't know. And I went through the church in New York. And I thank God for every member of the church in New York. And I thank God for the church in Boston and Syracuse. You know, I think as I've gotten older, I know I'm not that old. But as I've gotten older, I think my appreciation and my gratitude has just grown. For God, for His kingdom. And for those visiting today, I am not the regular preacher. Corey is. So if you have any problems with anything that I say, you can talk to Corey when he gets back next week. But I'm not a preacher. I love to preach, but I'm not the preacher. But hopefully this message will it'll be a good message for your heart. You know, George Burns once said, I know many of you don't even know who George Burns is. George Burns was a comedian, a great comedian. And he died, I think, at like 99 or 100 years old, and he was amazing. But he was asked one time, what makes a good sermon? He thought for a minute, and he said, well, a good sermon must have a great introduction, it must have a great conclusion, and the two must be as close together as possible. I'm not sure how well I'll do with that definition, but I'll give it my best shot. You know, at the 2004 Democratic National Convention, Barack Obama gave the keynote address, and what many believe to be one of the greatest political speeches ever given. It was a speech that would lift him from the possibility of being a congressman to the level and the tier of presidential consideration. And it was a speech that would define his beliefs and his vision for America. In his speech, he spoke of the hope we can have in America with the right leadership. He talked about having hope in the face of uncertainty. He talked about having hope in the face of difficulty. And he called the speech the Audacity of Hope. This morning, I'm not going to talk about hope. I'm going to talk about love. The love we can have for each other. The love we can have for a world that has lost the true meaning of love. And the true power of love. Love in the face of hatred. Love in the face of bigotry. Love in the face of self-preservation. Simply the audacity of love. Your audacity is defined as boldness with confident disregard for conventional thought or restrictions. And that was Jesus' life. That was how he lived. He lived with boldness, with confident disregard for what the world thought love was all about. And that's what he called us to. That's what he spoke about. And that's what he was driving to when he spoke about loving your enemies in Matthew 6. Remember that? When somebody wants to sue you for your tunic, what do? You give them your cloak as well. If someone forces you to walk 1 mile, what do? You walk 2 miles. If someone strikes you on the right cheek, what do? That's the audacity of love. It's a blatant and confident disregard for the conventional thinking of this world. The audacity of love is the kind of love our world is longing for. Our critics are watching for, and our enemies are totally unprepared for. It's the kind of love that will win this world over. The summer of 1980 in Miami was nothing to smile about. The Florida heat scorched the city during the day and baked it at night. Riots, lootings, and racial tension threatened to snap the frayed emotions of the people. Everything soared. Unemployment, inflation, the crime rate, and especially the thermometer. Somewhere in the midst of it all, a Miami Herald reporter captured a story that left the entire Gold Coast breathless. It was the story of Judith Bucknell, attractive, young, successful, and dead. Judith Bucknell was homicide number 106 that year. She was killed on a steamy June 9th evening, age 38, weight 109 pounds, stabbed 7 times, and strangled. She kept a diary. Had she not kept this diary, perhaps the memory of her would have been buried with her body. But the diary exists, a painful epitaph to a lonely life. The correspondent made this comment about her writings. In her diaries, Judith created a character and a voice. The character is herself, wistful, struggling, weary. The voice is yearning. Judith Bucknell has failed to connect. Age 38, many lovers, much love offered, none returned. Her struggles weren't unusual. She worried about getting old, getting fat, getting married, getting pregnant, and getting by. She lived in stylish Coconut Grove. And Coconut Grove is where you live if you're lonely but you act happy. Judy was the paragon of the confused human being. Half her life was fantasy, half was nightmare. Successful as a secretary, but a loser at love. Her diary was replete with entries such as the following. Where are the men with flowers and champagne and music? Where are the men who call and ask for a genuine, actual date? Where are the men who would like to share more than my bed, my booze, and my food? I would like to have in my life, once before I pass through my life, the kind of sexual relationship which is part of a loving relationship. She never did. Judy was not a prostitute. She was not on drugs or on welfare. She never went to jail. She was not a social outcast. She was respectable. She jogged. She hosted parties. She wore designer clothes and had an apartment that overlooked the bay. And she was very lonely. I see people together, and I'm so jealous I want to throw up. What about me? What about me? Though surrounded by people, she was an island. Though she had many acquaintances, she had few friends. Though she had many lovers, 59 and 56 months, she had little love. Who is going to love Judy Bucknell? The diary continues. I feel so old, unloved, unwanted, abandoned, used up. I want to cry and sleep forever. A clear message came from her aching words. Though her body died on June 9th from the wounds of a knife, her heart had died long before from loneliness. I'm alone, she wrote, and I want to share something with somebody. You know, this story was in 1980. But just think of how many exact same stories we've heard about since then. This is where we live. The world we live in. You know, Norman Cousins, author, editor, and writer, he once wrote, "Death is not the greatest loss in life. The greatest loss is what dies inside us while we live." You know, this could have been written about many of us. This could have been our diary. A life of loneliness, no true love, no deep relationships, no inspiring friendships. Maybe there's someone here today, this morning, that is feeling this way. Because this is the world we live in. You know, last night, many people were either drowning their loneliness in mixed drinks, drugs, to try to forget how lonely they really are. And some sat on their beds wondering if they would ever experience true love. Wondering if they would ever have the kind of loving relationships that are deep and honest and respectful and caring and considerate and fulfilling and secure. The kind of relationships we as disciples often take for granted. This is why, guys, this is why our missions is so important. This is why we do what we do. This is why we collect missions. This is why we send people out to reach as many as possible. Just many people just like you and me to reach as many as possible. You know, that's why we plant Lagos. Because there are millions of people there who are feeling like an island. That's why we planted Seattle. That's why we're going to plant Dubai. And Lord willing, that's why next year we're going to plant Hong Kong. Missions is so important. People are lonely. They're dying alone. And we are their hope. You know, I'll often, in our Bible talk, I'll often start a Bible talk with saying, you know, if an alien came down to Earth, walked around for a week, looking at billboards or watching TV or going to the movies or reading newspapers or magazine ads, and then was asked at the end of the week, how would you describe the word love? What do you think he'd say? You know, one thing he'd say is, well, I think it has something to do with these little handheld devices. You know, because I see couples at tables all the time, and they're not talking to each other. They're just doing something with this handheld device. Guys, we live in a different world today than what I grew up in. You know, to call Kama or to contact Kama from Montana to New York, it was a long-distance landline phone call. And it was so expensive that I had to start writing letters. So I just started writing letters every day. We didn't have the little cell phones. I'll tell you what. Hey, I love the convenience, but these things have separated people so much. I remember going through the subways in New York City, and everyone, bar none, everyone focused on their little handheld device, not paying attention to anyone else, but just on their phone. Facebook, Twitter, you know, whatever else is out there. That's the world we live in. People say, well, you know, man, Facebook is so good because it connects people. This doesn't connect people. Sitting down with somebody and having a conversation connects people. these things divide people. And I'll tell you, can I be honest with you? It drives me nuts when I see people in church putting stuff on Facebook and playing with their little device when somebody's trying to give up here or when we're trying to have service. It's just not right, guys. See, more than likely, the alien would say, love is based on sexuality. Love is based on just friendly acquaintances. Nothing deep, mostly superficial. He would say, I think love involves infatuation. It involves pleasure. It involves getting and giving gifts. And the bigger the gift, the more love, right? You ever seen that Buick commercial? Where the husband with his wife, and he just buys her this new car. Has a big red bow on it. She's like so fired up. She's like, wow, this is great. Until the bigger, better car drives by. And she watches it as it drives by. And her husband's like, what about this? What about this, you know? The fact is, the world does not understand true love. I think we can even forget it in the church. I think we can get caught up in worldliness, with ingratitude, and we can become pleasure seekers rather than lovers of God and lovers of each other. Over in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Any of this connecting? 1 Corinthians 13. Verse 31. It says, but eagerly desire the greater gifts, and now I will show you the most excellent way. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have the faith that can move mountains but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor, surrender my body to the flames, but have not love, I gain nothing. The most excellent way. You know, the Phillips translation says it's the way that surpasses them all. You know, the Apostle John, the last apostle to die, he actually discipled the church into the second century through men like Polycarp and other guys that he was discipling. And tradition has it that his repeated words of exhortation at the end of his life were simply this: little children, love one another. And they'd ask him, well, how should we do this? Or how should we handle that? Or, you know, what should we do in this situation? And he would simply say, just love one another. See, John and Paul knew what love was. They knew the power of love. You know, Paul says here in verse 1, you can have all the eloquence of men or angels, but if you don't have love, you're just a resounding gong. You're a clanging cymbal. Ever remember the gong show? Yeah. You don't remember that. Well, that's... sorry. You can actually look at it on YouTube, though, and get the idea. Clanging cymbal. You ever hear of a clanging cymbal? If your life is not loving, and your life does not back up your message, that's exactly what you sound like. If you're a leader in God's church, Bible talk leader, intern, evangelist, you've got to have a genuine love for every member you lead. Or you're just blowing wind. You're just sounding obnoxious. Your life has got to back up your message. And guys, we need leaders. All right, I'm just going to give my 2 cents here while I'm up here. I don't have another chance to do that, but I'm going to go ahead and do it now. You know, we need leaders. We need young men to have visions. We need to have old men to dream dreams. We need to have old men to dream dreams of the kingdom of God again. We need young men and women to aspire to be Bible Talk leaders and interns. If you're over a year old in the Lord, you need to be looking to be an intern or a Bible Talk leader. There's no reason why you can't rise up and lead a small group. Some of you older folks, you know who I'm talking to here. You need to aspire to use your years of wisdom and your life experience to shepherd people, especially the older women. You know, we need the older women to rise up and lead our younger women. And how do you get started? Just do it. Just do it. I mean, seek some advice, work hard, but do it. You know, if you're a parent or a spouse, that was my 2 cents worth, so pay me later. If you're a parent or a spouse, and there's not love backing up what you're saying, you will only exasperate your child or your spouse. You can't speak to your kids or your wife in anger and love them at the same time. You just can't. You'll sound like a gong. You'll sound like a cymbal. And all they're going to do is cringe. Verse 2. You can think you're the most spiritual person living on earth. Foretell the future. Hold all knowledge and absolute faith. But if you don't have love, you amount to nothing. Nothing. Nothing to people, nothing to God if you don't have love. That's what the Pharisees were. That's why Jesus was so frustrated with them. It's because they thought they were super spiritual, but they lacked love. And they amounted to nothing. In fact, God called them whitewashed tombs. He called them vipers and hypocrites and blind guides and sons of hell. That's what God thinks of someone who thinks they're spiritual, but they don't have love. And I pray that we'll be so much different than that. I pray that we'll be the shining stars of love. Amen. And verse 3. You can be the greatest missionary. Sacrifice all you have to the poor. Even sacrifice your life and become a martyr. If you don't have love, you will achieve precisely nothing. No heavenly welcome. No applaud from God. No applaud from the Father. Nothing. Love is the most excellent way. And without love, we are nothing. Paul and John understood this. And Paul goes on here to say what love is and what love isn't. If you ever want to understand how to be more loving, here is your list. This is your list. He says, love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. If you want to find out how you're doing with love, just talk to somebody close to you and let them honestly evaluate you according to this list. If you want to know how you're doing spiritually, let somebody evaluate you and your love according to this list. You know, this was one of the first scriptures we had our son Joel memorize. And he memorized it as a child. And I think he still has it memorized. But we wanted him to know whether he was a disciple or not, whether he became a Christian or not. We want him to know what true love is. And we don't have time to go through all these. But aren't they true? I mean, love is patient. Have you ever known a loving person who's impatient? You know, a patient person is more concerned about someone else's agenda than their own. They're quick to listen. They're slow to speak, and they're slow to become angry. That's a patient person. Love is kind. Is a loving person unkind? How about this? Doesn't envy. Love doesn't envy. Does a loving person want someone else's car or house or wife or situation? Is that a loving person? Doesn't boast. The loving people go about and boast about their accomplishments or how wonderful they are. Is that a loving person? How about proud? Is not proud. What does pride breed in us? Pride breeds insecurity. You can't love somebody if you're insecure. It breeds anger. You certainly can't love somebody if you're angry. It breeds an openness. Can you really love someone if you're not open with your life? It breeds independence. It's impossible to love others if you're independent. You know, independence doesn't pull people in. Independence pushes people away. That's what pride does. You know, these things just make sense, don't they? I mean, it doesn't take an advanced degree to figure them out. Even a UIC student can figure it out. They can get it. I mean, it's just common sense. But it's challenging to apply. Look over in John chapter 13. John chapter 13, verse 1. It was just before the Passover feast. Jesus knew that the time had come for him to leave this world and to go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he now showed them the full extent of his love. The evening meal was being served, and the devil had already prompted Judas Iscariot, son of Simon, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under him, under his power, and that he had come from God and was returned to God. So he got up, he wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin, began to wash his disciples' feet, drying them with the towel that was wrapped around him. Let's look at a few aspects of love here. Jesus washing the feet of the disciples. You know, John chapter 12 and verse 50, that marked the end of his public career, his public ministry. In chapter 13, verse 1 was the beginning of the passion account. And many historians believe that this situation took place the Thursday before crucifixion Friday. I mean, the day before. Verse 1 says that this act, this loving gesture, was to show his disciples the full extent of his love. That he would love them to the end. This was the epitome of Jesus' love for his disciples. That his love would not end with his physical ministry on earth, but that his love had no limits. And I want you to think about this. If you knew that you were going to die, would you expect to be the one washing or expect to be the one being washed? The one showing his love or the one being loved by others? You know, normally they would have a servant come in and wash the feet of the disciples in a meeting like this, but this was a secret meeting. So there was no servant present. And none of the disciples were jumping up to volunteer. I'll do it, I'll wash the feet. In fact, in Luke's account, it says that as they were coming into the room, they were arguing who was the greatest among them. So to volunteer to wash the feet would have been considered an admission of inferiority to the others, and they were not going to do that. So sometime during the meal, Jesus got up, he removed his outer cloak, and wrapped a servant's towel around himself. and he began to perform the work of the servant who wasn't there. I want you to ask yourself, whether you're a leader or the newest Christian here, amen. Whether you've been around a long time or a very short time, whether you're a husband or a wife, parent or a child, boss or an employee, are you the one expecting to be washed and served, or are you the one who's washing, doing the washing yourself? You know, and I read a good book. You can read it sometime. It's called The Servant, and it talked about even bosses washing the feet of their employees and how important that is in building a company. But what do I mean by this? Well, I'm glad you asked. So we're gonna get some practicals here. Husbands and roommates, what's your attitude when you come home from work? I am going to talk about it. You sitting around waiting to be served? Or are you the one who's getting up, putting the towel on, getting busy with the work of washing the feet of your wife, your husband, or your children's? Or your roommates, for you, those of you who are in a roommate situation. Do you come home expecting and anticipating being the servant or being the servee? You know, I appreciate Alex Diaz so much. Is Alex in? You know, this guy, he is becoming a servant to his wife, Peggy. And he's learning to lead his family. He's being a great father to his boys. He's working hard at taking care of Peggy's needs. Now, you know how I know that? It's not because I go to their house all the time and just sit there in the corner and watch. In fact, we've only been over there once. But I know that because Peggy is radiant. Peggy is becoming radiant. She's becoming happy, joyful, spiritual. That's a woman who's loved and served by her husband. That's what happens. See, that's the outcome of service. If you're a husband, that's the outcome of service, is your wife becomes radiant. You know, I look at Victor and Amana. You know, servants, young kids, servants, they love God. And they love God because their mother has served God, people, and their family tirelessly for years. Ginger, you have given your heart and soul to this church and to your family. And guys, that's the only way that we're going to raise up the next generation to take the message to this lost world, is to be servant disciples, to be great servants ourselves. You know, practically speaking, are you willing to do the menial jobs, or you just want to do the jobs that are highly visible? You know, I appreciate all the guys who do the menial, behind the scenes jobs, the invisible jobs. You know, Henry. Dre. Jimmy. Kiwanti. Frank. John. Brandon. All those guys. Nana. These guys just give. They do the behind-the-scenes stuff. And, you know, that's not even talking about the ushers and those who set up communion and hand out communion. And this morning I just got a chance to talk with the teachers. It is such an honor to be a teacher in the kingdom. You know, I told them how much I appreciate them, because being a parent and having our kids grow up in Kids Kingdom, you can't, there's no amount of money you can put on something like that. To know that my kids are getting taught and trained is absolutely phenomenal. They don't get paid. They do it because they love kids and they love God. These are the people that I feel like I could ask them anything. I could ask Jimmy to do anything. I know he'd do it. Yeah, you. I know. That's the heart of Jesus. But how about at home? You guys joyfully willing to wash the dishes? Your brothers? Are you willing to clean the bathroom? Vacuum, dust. Husbands, do you go home and ask your wife if you can dust and vacuum the house? See, that's simply being like Jesus. And what about when you do volunteer for something? Do you do it excellently? You know, that's a whole other aspect of being a servant. Is doing what you do excellently. You know, I think when Jesus got done with his disciples' feet, I bet they were cleaner than they'd ever been before. He didn't just kind of wipe them down, you know, spit shine them. He cleaned them. He may have even given them a pedicure. I don't know. But they were clean when he was done. You know, when you volunteer, do you do it excellently? Do you go over and above? Or do you do just enough to get by? You know, I appreciate so much Pat Jr. Pat has, you know, when I left here in 2012. When I left here in 2012, Pat, they moved out to L.A. And, you know, Pat was, he was a good musician, but he wasn't great. But you know, when he came back here and he leads the song leaders, he's amazing. He has he's not only learned the bass part, he's learned all the parts of a lot of the songs. And he's taught himself, he's teaching himself to read music. He didn't have to do that. He did it because he's trying to be excellent in everything he does. Are you solution-oriented? Are you looking for solutions and ways to serve better? Yeah. You know, it's like seeing the needs and coming up with solutions and running them by Corey and G and the shepherds and then doing them. It's not, here's the problem. What are you guys going to do about it? That's not being a servant. Yeah. It really comes down to being invested. You know, there's a difference between contributing to the kingdom of God and being invested in it. You know, contributing is you're here, you chip in, you help out, you donate, you know, you're here. You're giving when you can. But see, investing means that you're committed heart and soul. That what you do with all your heart. What you do, you give it all your might. And that's what it means to be invested. It means to envelop yourself in whatever you're doing. That's why, man, when we do missions, when we take up missions contribution, we need to do it with all our heart. When you come to church or Bible talk or midweek, do you come with a heart to give or do you come expecting to get? To be encouraged. I'm just, yeah, I'm here. Where is everybody coming up to me? Yeah, they're coming up. Yeah. Gee, no one's coming up to me. What's going on? You know? And, you know, it's obvious. I've been there. I've been there. I've wanted to come into church and have everybody come to me instead of looking around and looking for needs. You know, but it's obvious. Those who come in who are looking to give, they're excited. Their Bibles are open. They're buzzing. They're going from person to person. They're asking people how they're doing. Those who come to get are just kind of stand around. And, you know, they look kind of out of place. And or they just leave. Are you invested? Or are you contributing? And again, I've been at both ends. There have been times when I've wanted to get out of fellowship so fast. But, you know, it's those times that I'm tanking it. I'm just not doing well. And it's then that I've got to go and make a decision to change and be different and have my heart change and start looking for needs in the congregation. We're all going to be there at one point or another. You know, we're all going to have times when we're just stinking it up spiritually. But that's not the time to fold, guys. It's not the time to leave. Although everything in you wants to leave, it's the time to make a decision to get open, lay your burdens down, and go after meeting someone's needs. That's what church needs to be. And it takes a lot of prayer. So when you come to church, guys, get prayed up and decide to give. When you're on your way home, guys, get prayed up and decide to wash the feet of your wife or your children or your roommates. When you're getting up, when you're going to school, when you're going to work, when you're going to your yoga class, when you're going to your underwater basket weaving, whatever you're going to, get prayed up and decide to give, because that's what disciples do. Amen? Back John 13. Look at the excuses Jesus could have made. Verse 2. One of his closest friends, Judas, had been prompted by Satan to betray Jesus. He would later hand him over to be mocked, tortured, ridiculed, beaten, and crucified. But Jesus did not pass Judas by. He knew all that was going to happen, and he washed the feet of Judas as well. What's your heart in loving and serving your enemies? Or those who treat you unlovingly? When you've been wrong, mistreated, accused, slandered, gossiped about, we all have. Are you willing to wash the feet of those people as well as those who love you? This is unconditional love. This is loving when love is not deserved or warranted. And this is the kind of audacity that we need to have in loving our enemies. It's hard to love those who don't give back anything in return, isn't it? You know, you give and give and give and give and give and give and get nothing. And God says, give some more. Serve some more. Do what you can to love some more. Who is it that you can't love? Is it your boss? Your ex-husband? Your ex-wife? The friend who's betrayed your trust? Maybe it's the Judas in your life. I want to challenge you today to go after loving that person, whoever it is. Go after it. Don't leave here today knowing that there's somebody that you haven't loved and haven't served because of attitudes or because of your heart. Don't leave here today without a plan on how to go after that person. That's Jesus. You know, and let's be honest. Can we be honest here? Sometimes we have a hard time loving others because we're unwilling to forgive other people. You know, resolving conflict. We had a Bible talk. this last week. I think it was this last week on resolving conflict. And someone was talking about just being really open about their life and their relationships and how they had been wronged and how they had forgave that person. They felt they had forgiven that person. But they still had that weird feeling when they were around them. You ever do that? In fact, sure, I forgive you. But then you're just around them and you feel kind of weird. Right? Maybe it's a brother or sister in the church. Maybe you feel kind of weird around somebody at church. And what I had to tell them was, it's not resolved. If you feel weird around somebody, you're not resolved with that person. You're not loving that person. You need to get resolved. This was a person at work. Maybe there's somebody at work who you feel weird around. She said, well, what should I do? And I said, well, the first thing you can do is bake a plate of cookies and bring it to him. Write him a note and tell him all the things that you appreciate about him. And, you know, that's part of it too, right? It's finding things that you appreciate in people. Sometimes we have a hard time finding things that we appreciate in others. And we need to repent of that too. We need to be able to look at somebody and appreciate all that God has done for them and all that God has done in them. But, you know, sometimes people annoy us. And we don't love them with all our heart. And guys, that's just wrong. That's not right. Sometimes we've been hurt and we refuse to forgive somebody. We're unwilling to go there. Well, let me remind you of Matthew 6. 14-15, don't need to turn there, but it simply says that there's some things in the Bible that won't keep us out of heaven, right? Unforgiveness is not one of them. It's not an opinion matter. It's not like, well, you know, maybe I'll go to heaven. No. You don't forgive somebody, you will not go to heaven. No exemptions. Jesus said, if you don't forgive, you will not be forgiven. If you forgive, you'll be forgiven. But if you don't forgive, you won't be forgiven. Guys, we need to be forgiving. Are you going to be hurt by somebody? Absolutely. Are you going to hurt somebody? Absolutely. That's the beauty of God's kingdom. It's a perfect church, but it's made up of imperfect people. We need to learn to forgive. You know, Martin Luther once said, he who passively accepts evil is as much involved in it as he who helps perpetrate it. He who accepts evil without protesting against it is really cooperating with it. And he also said, in the end, we will remember not the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends. We need to, another aspect of loving is telling the truth, telling people the truth. Let's close in John 13. Verse 2, the evening.